Okay, good morning everyone. So how are you today? So I am praying that you are always in good and fine conditions. So today we'll be going to study about theories and techniques of counseling, no, from the different approaches. So for example, we'll be studying the theories made by the psychoanalytic therapy, the Adlerian therapy, the existential therapy, the person-centered therapy, the gestalt therapy, the behavior therapy, cognitive behavior therapy, reality therapy, feminist therapy, postmodern approaches in therapy, and family system therapy. So these are the different theories and some techniques in counseling. So they have provided us techniques and theories on how we will conduct our counseling. So specifically, this time we will be studying psychoanalytic therapy. Okay, so that will be our lesson for today. But before we continue with our lesson, let us come to God in prayer and let us acknowledge God to help us understand this kind of theories and techniques in counseling, so that in our application of that principles, we can effectively implement the techniques and theories in counseling in our ministries. So again, we are studying this because there are some pastors who immediately diagnose the individual with psychological problem, which they believe have demonic possession. So here we will try to analyze the difference, no, of the secular counseling versus some issue on spiritual or counseling that has demonic influence. Okay, so but before we continue with our lesson, let us come to God in prayer once again, because we believe that without God, no, we all know that we are nothing. So let us come to God in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we come to you, Lord God, this morning, and we worship you and we glorify you, Lord God. We recognize you, Lord, as our great teacher, because we believe, Lord, without you, we are nothing. So today, Lord, as we study this lesson on the theories and techniques of counseling, specifically the psychoanalytic therapy, we pray, Lord, that you will continue to guide us and teach us, Lord. And we believe, Lord, that all truths are parallel, all truths comes from you. And that's why, Lord God, we believe, Lord, that these theories and techniques, as part of the principles of counseling, Lord, will help us in our ministries, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, Lord God, for your helping us become equipped in the ministries and the calling that you have called us to do. We commit to you everything, Lord God, and this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Okay, so let's continue. So the key concept that we need to notice and identify here are the view of human nature in regards to this psychoanalytic therapy. What or how the psychoanalytic therapy view human nature. Next, through the psychoanalytic therapy, what are the structure of personality? How can a person understand by the counselor. The third one, the consciousness and unconsciousness, no? That this psychoanalytic therapy has the idea of consciousness and unconsciousness, okay? What are transpired in the concept of consciousness and unconsciousness. Next one, we'll try to study the anxiety. Okay, and we'll also discuss the ego defense mechanism. Now, what are the defense mechanism of individual when they are having troubles in life? And the last one here is the development of personality. Okay? So, where this idea of psychoanalytic theories came from? Okay? To whom this idea started? Okay? Okay? It started from Sigmund Freud from 1856 to 1939. Okay? So, Sigmund Freud was the first born in a Viennese family of 3 boys and 5 girls. His father, like many others of his time and place, was very authoritarian. Freud's family background is a factor to consider in understanding the development of this theory or his theory. So even though Freud's family have limited finances and was forced to live in a crowded apartment, his parents made every effort to foster his obvious intellectual capacities. Freud had many interests, but his career choices were restricted because of his Jewish heritage. He finally settled on medicine. Only 4 years after earning his medical degree from the University of Vienna at the age of 26, he attained a prestige position there as a lecturer. So, Freud devoted most of his life to formulating and extending his theory of psychoanalysis. Again, he is the proponent of the theory of psychoanalysis. Interestingly, the most creative phase of his life corresponds to a period when he was experiencing severe emotional problems of his own. During his early 40s, Freud had numerous psychosomatic disorder as well as exaggerated fears of dying and other phobias, and was involved in the difficult task of self-analysis. By exploring the meaning of his own dreams, he gained insights into the dynamic of personality development. Okay, so that is what he did, no? So he first examined his childhood memories and came to realize the intense hostility he had felt for his father. No, he has problem with his father. He also recalled his attractive, loving, and protective, no? Mother, okay? Yan. So, he first examined his first childhood memories and came to realize the intense hostility he had felt for his father. He also recalled his childhood sexual feelings for his mother, who was attractive, loving, and protective. He then clinically formulated his theory as he observed his patients work through their own problems. So, Sigmund Freud has, you know, psychological problem. No? he was attracted to his beautiful mother, no? And he tried to solve his a problem, psychological problem, no? And try to make it through clinical studies. So, Prud also had very little tolerance for colleagues who diverged from his psychoanalytic doctrine. He attempted to control over the movement by expelling those who dared to disagree. You see? So something in mind of Sigmund Freud, where he has problem with other colleagues. Carl Jung and Alfred Adler, for example, worked closely with Sigmund Freud, but each founded his own therapeutic school after repeated disagreements with Sigmund Freud on theoretical and clinical issue. So, we see that Sigmund Freud was highly creative and productive, frequently putting in 18 hours days. His collected work filled 24 volumes. Sigmund Freud's productivity remained at this prolific level until late in his life when he contracted cancer of the jaws. During his last two decades, he underwent 33 operations and was in almost constant pain. He died in London in 1939. So, as the originator of psychoanalysis, Sigmund Freud distinguished himself as an intellectual giant. He pioneered new techniques for understanding human behavior, and his effort resulted in the most comprehensive theory of personality and psychotherapy ever developed. So, again, Sigmund Freud has many contribution in the study of psychoanalytic, no? So, Sigmund Freud's view continue to influence contemporary practices. Many of his basic concepts are still part of the foundation on which other theories build and develop. Most of the theories of counseling and psychotherapy discussed by Sigmund Freud, have been influenced by the psychoanalytic principles and techniques. Okay, he created some psychoanalytic principles and techniques that was being used in counseling or psychotherapy. No, some of these therapeutic approaches extended the psychoanalytic model. Others modified its concept and produced procedures, and others emerged as a reaction against it. So Sigmund Freud's psychoanalytic system is a model of personality development and an approach to psychotherapy. He gave psychotherapy a new look and new horizons, calling attention to psychodynamic factors that motivate behavior, focusing on the role of the unconscious, and developing the first therapeutic procedures for understanding and modifying the structure of one's basic character. So, Sigmund Freud's theory is a benchmark against which many other theories measured. Okay? So, let's go with the concept of psychoanalytic therapy. So, what is the view of human nature in this psychoanalytic therapy? The Sigmund or the Preudian view of human nature is basically deterministic. It means you can determine. According to Freud, our behavior is determined by irrational forces, unconscious motivations, and biological and instinctual drives as these evolve through key psychosexual stages in the first year of life. So, for the psychoanalytic therapy, so there is the behavior, okay? So, in other words, any behavior presented by the clients are determined by his irrational forces. Even, you know, they are not thinking. That is in their subconscious mind. Unconscious motivation and biological and instinctual drives. So their behavior, the client's behavior, is based on their instinctual drives, based on their irrational forces. No? Instinct are central to the Freudian approach, although he originally used the term libido to refer to sexual energy. He later broadened it to include the energy of all the life instincts. So for the psychoanalytic theory by Sigmund Freud, he believed that every individual person has or possess the energy of life instinct. Okay? So this instinct served the purpose of the survival of the individual and the human race. They are oriented toward growth, development, and creativity. So for him, libido should be understood as a source of motivation that encompasses sexual energy but goes beyond it. So Sigmund Freud includes all pleasurable acts in his concept of the life instinct. He sees the goal of much of life as gaining pleasure and avoiding pain. So for Sigmund Freud, he believes that everyone behave based on the instinct. And that instinct should be for pleasure. So for example, why some other people goes with smoking, goes with drinking, goes with drug addiction, goes with sex. So why? Because he believed that it is their instinct. Okay? And the goal of life is for pleasure. Okay, and the goal of life also is gaining pleasure and not pain. So, not for controlling the pleasure of life. Okay? So, what is the structure of personality according to Sigmund Freud as part of the psychoanalytic therapy? So, according to the Freudian psychoanalytic view, the personality of person consists of three systems. No? So, number one is the id, number two is the ego, and number three is the superego. These names are names for psychological structure and should not be thought of as mannequins that separately operates the personality. So this is one. So one's personality function as a whole rather than as a three discrete segments. So this is the whole personality of man. No? So the id is roughly all the untamed, you cannot control, drives or impulses that might be likened to the biological component. So the id is the uncontrolled part of your personality. These are more on the instinct or what we call the libido concept. The ego attempts to organize and mediate between the id and the reality of danger posed by the id's impulse. So yung ego, the ego is the one who controlled the id, the pleasure, the libid, the libido. Okay? One way to protect ourselves from the danger of our own drive is to establish a superego. So there is id, the uncontrolled impulse, the biological components, and the other one is the ego, the one who react to control the danger of the id. And the superego, which help us to choose the correct and moral behavior. Okay, superego, which is the internalized social components, largely rooted in what the person imagined to be expectations of parental figure. For example, the person is smoking. So, according to parental figures or societal morality, smoking is dangerous to everybody's health. So, that is the superego. So, the id wants to smoke because there is problem that needs to experience the pleasure of smoking. So the ego will behave. He will control his ego, his id, and try to align his behavior into what we call the social components, the expectation of parental figures. So because the point of taking in this imagined expectation is to protect ourselves from our own impulses, the superego may be punitive and demanding than the person's parent really were. So action of the ego may or may not be conscious. The example is defenses typically are not conscious, okay? So because ego or consciousness are not the same, the slogan for psychoanalysis has shifted from making the unconscious conscious to where there was id, let there be ego. Okay? So, from the orthodox Freudian perspective, superego are viewed as energy system. The dynamics of personality consist of the ways in which psychic energy is distributed to the id, ego, and superego. Because the amount of energy is limited, one system gains control over the available energy at the expense of the other two systems. So behavior is determined by the psychic energy, whether it is more on id or more on ego or more on superego. So it means this psychic energy will empower one of the three. One of the three. So the one will be greater, the two is lesser. So that's why this is the dealing of the psychoanalytic therapy that need to empower the superego, which will result to a moral active behavior. Okay? So the id, okay? So let's expound it. The id is the original system of personality. At birth, a person is all id. So the id is the primary source of psychic energy. And the seat of it, or the seat of the instinct. Okay, so always the instinct is what everyone like to do, like to enjoy, no? It is the seat of pleasure. It lacks organization and is blind, no? Demanding and insistent. So what is the character of the id? Lack of organization, blind, and this is demanding. That's why if a person wants to smoke, he wants to smoke, no? Demanding, and then insistent. A cauldron of seething excitement. The id cannot tolerate tension, and it functions to discharge tension immediately. So, ruled by the pleasure principle. Okay, again, it is ruled by the pleasure principle, which is aimed at reducing tension, avoiding pain, and gaining pleasure. The id is what? Illogical, amoral, and driven to satisfy instinctual needs. The id never mature, remaining the spoiled brat of personality. It does not think, but only wishes or acts. The id is largely unconscious or out of awareness. So this is unconscious. This is in the pleasure principle. So the id push. The id is demanding. The id is insistent. The id trying to experience the pleasure. So that is the id. How about the ego? The ego has contact with the external world of reality, meaning this is the present life. It is the executive that governs, controls, and regulates the personality. So meaning he can do the id or he can do the superego. Okay? He can do the id or he can, it can stop it, no? Or do the superego. As a traffic cop, it mediates between the instinct and the surrounding environment. The ego controls consciousness and exercises censorship, ruled by what we call reality principles. The ego does realistic and logical thinking and formulates plan of action for satisfying needs. The ego, as the seat of intelligence and rationality, checks and controls the blind impulse of the id, whereas the id knows only subjective reality. The ego distinguishes between mental image and things in the external world. So you see here that ego is the one who serves as the police, okay, or the traffic cop. He mediates the instinct and the surrounding environment. So this is the one who act. Okay? The one who act, the one who think. The one who formulate plans, that is the ego. Okay, for example, the id wants a sexual pleasure to experience, and the ego will think how he can do it. Is he going to go to beer house and get some woman there, or he will plan to rape? So this is the one who thinks, check, controls, no? How about the superego? The superego is the judicial branch of personality, the one who determine the moral and the ethical part of society. It includes a person's moral code, the main concerns being whether an action is good or bad, right or wrong. It represents the ideal rather than the real, and strives not for pleasure but for perfection. The superego represents the traditional values and the ideals of society as they are handed down from parents to children. Okay, it functions to inhibit the id impulses, to persuade the ego to substitute moralistic goal for realistic ones, and to strive for perfection. The superego then, as the internalization of the standard of parents and society, is related to psychological rewards and punishment. So the rewards are feeling of pride and self-love. The punishment are feelings of guilt and inferiority. So again, superego is the one who inhibits the impulse of the id. And then this is the one who do the ideal, not the real. So for example, the reality is that your classmates are smoking and you're the only one who are not. So trying to join with them for pleasure, but there is the superego who is trying to help you to choose not to join your classmates in their smoking. So that is the role of the superego. So how can we illustrate it, no? So this is the model of personality structure of Sigmund Freud. So you see here, he used the illustration of the iceberg. So here you see the iceberg is the conscious, okay? The psychological components, the ego, this is the reality principles, secondary process thinking. So this is the behavioral process, a scene. So the id is under, it is more big in scope, no? Because as we see the iceberg, we just see the tip. And the tip is, sometimes we amaze, it is big, but in the bottom of it is more bigger than the tip. Huh? So this is under the ego is the id, the pleasure principle, primarily process thinking. This is the wish fulfillment, no? Biological components, the instinct, the eros and thanatos are associated with the unconscious mind and the id. No, and in the right side, the social components, the morality, the moral imperatives, this is the superego, contains the conscience and the ego ideal. No, you see? So on the right side, so the consciousness or the conscious contact with outside world, the preconscious material just beneath the surface of awareness, and the unconscious mind, no? The unconscious mind, the difficult to retrieve materials, well below the surface of awareness, no? Feel psychiatric energy originates in the unconscious. Okay, so these are the personality, no? What about the consciousness and the unconscious? Perhaps Freud's greatest contribution are his concept of the unconscious and of the level of consciousness, which are the key to understanding behavior and the problem of personality. So, in order for us to solve psychological problem, we need to understand the consciousness and the unconscious. So the unconscious cannot be studied directly, but is inferred from behavior. So there are clinical evidences for postulating the unconscious includes the following, no? Number one, dreams, okay? Which are symbolic representation of unconscious needs, wishes, and conflicts. So what are their dreams? The second one is the slips of the tongue and forgetting. For example, a familiar name, no? So a slip of the tongue. Number three, the post-hypnotic suggestions. Number four, the material derived from pre-association techniques. Number five, the material derived from projective techniques. And number six, the symbolic content of psychotic symptoms. So these are actually the clinical evidence. So it is hard for us, no, to expound these things. Why? Because we are not in practice of the what we call the clinical practice. No, we are not psychologists, or we are not the doctor, no, the psychiatrist. Okay, so just leave these things, because these are for the expert. Okay. For Sigmund Freud, consciousness is a thin slice of the total mind. Thin slice. So like the greater part of the iceberg that lies below the surface of the water, the larger part of the mind exists below the surface of awareness. No? The unconscious stores all experiences, memories, and repressed materials, needs and motivations that are inaccessible, that is out of awareness, are also outside the sphere of conscious control. Most psychological functioning exists in the out of awareness realm. So the game or the aim of psychological functioning exists. No, sorry. The aim of psychoanalytic therapy is to make the unconscious motives conscious. For only then can an individual exercise choice. Understanding the role of the unconscious is central to grasping the essence of the psychoanalytic model of therapy. So, I will give you an example. For example, A person experience what's this? A punishment from their parents, no? And up to their adulthood, okay, that experience is still in their minds. So that's why they behave differently. They are afraid with talking with the adult. Or sometimes they are afraid to talk with their pastors. Why? Because they have past experience, no? With their parents. So that's why they are always angry. No, they are always angry with their older people. Okay, so they behave differently. They are always in fear when they are talking with the adults. So that is the example of this. So in psychoanalytic therapy, they need to know what is their experience in order to help them change their behavior in their adult people. Okay? So I will stop here. I will continue next meeting. So you need also to make your reflection paper based on the discussion. Okay, based on the lecture I had presented to you. Okay, so I will continue this lesson next meeting. Okay, so God bless you. Bye-bye for now.